You had questions, we have answers. Mike Meyer asks, how do we know the half-life of uranium well enough to use it accurately for measuring really long periods of time? That is a good question, because you cannot just stand over a sample of uranium oxide with a stopwatch. You would die about this far into its half-life. So basically, what scientists do is, instead of measuring the disappearance of the thing itself, they measure something else that's mathematically related to its disappearance. When uranium-238 decays, it turns into thorium. That thorium then decays into a whole bunch of other stuff. But the important thing is that when uranium decays, it releases an alpha particle. In other words, a helium nucleus. You can measure the release of those alpha particles in the lab, crunch the numbers. If you had a 1,000-gram sample of uranium-238, you would measure that it releases about 13 million alpha particles per second. Plug those numbers into this equation here, and there you go. The half-life of uranium-238 is about 4.5 billion years. You're not done, though. You've got to check this number against other radioactive dating measurements of the age of, say, a really old rock, like a meteorite. Why? Because we don't play around when it comes to the age of the Earth. A couple of people, including Nizar Al-Sabai, watched us dissolve gold in our video about acids and wanted to know, can you get it back? Yes, there are two main ways to retrieve gold once it's been dissolved: electroplating and precipitation. The simplest, in theory, way to retrieve gold from aqua regia was pointed out by the resident skeptic on our video about George de Hevesy, who dissolved the Nobel Prize in acid to hide it from the Nazis. Sometimes you mix two dissolved chemicals together and a solid comes crashing out. Here, for example, we made solid silver chloride by mixing solutions of copper chloride and silver nitrate. We call this a precipitation reaction. Now, when we dissolved the gold in aqua regia, it reacted to become chloroauric acid. Add sodium bisulfite, and solid gold precipitates right out. Like so. At least on paper. In real life, it might take a bit of patience and a lot of tries, and it's kind of tricky. Which brings us to the way people actually use electroplating. Electroplating is basically when you use electricity to coat one metal in a different metal. Here's how it works. We set up a beaker with our gold solution and two pieces of metal connected with some wire and a battery. As you can guess, this electrode over here becomes positively charged, and this one becomes negatively charged. Since the gold ions in solution are positively charged, they are attracted to the negative electrode. They move over there, and they get electrons from that negative electrode in a redox reaction. And that's how the positively charged gold ions become neutral gold metal atoms, which we can collect and give to smog. By the way, this is how the current United States penny is made, coating cheap zinc with a thin layer of copper. Keep those questions coming, and we'll answer them in a future Q&A, or maybe someone in the comments will see them and help you out. Thanks for asking, and we'll see you next time.